Hi, everybody. Welcome to Demo, the show where companies show us their latest products and platforms. We are here at Dell headquarters today, and we're talking with Munira Baldiwala. She's the Director of Commercial Mobility Product Management at Dell. So welcome to Demo.
Hey, Keith. Thanks for having me here.
Hey, thanks for having us here at the Dell Executive Briefing Center. This is a fantastic space. So what are you showing us here today?
Yeah, so I'm going to show you what Dell has up its sleeves in terms of AI PCs. We're going to talk through our flagship AI PCs product. I'll show you a little bit of, you know, what those products look like. And then let's look at some live demos on really bringing some of these AI use cases to life.
So yeah,
it really makes sense.
We've heard about AI PCs for a while now, and initially there was a lot of skepticism about, like, well, why does an end user need this, or why does an employee need this? So, you know, why should companies care about having an AI PC versus maybe a traditional computer?
Yeah, so you tell me. I mean, do you really need all day battery life? Do you want to make sure your system doesn't die while you're on a flight? Do you need a device that is going to last in terms of performance for a couple of more years, especially with all of these AI tasks getting right into it with all of these applications?
Yeah.
You also probably want your device to be thin and light. You want to be able to carry it around everywhere seamlessly while knowing that it is secure and reliable.
Yeah. So the extended battery life.
Yeah.
If you wanted to have a really long battery life, you probably had to have a giant battery that was about this high,
right.
and then your back is going to hurt and things like that.
Right.
So this allows you to get a smaller computer
yeah.
because the processor is taking care of a lot of the power management,
right,
correct?
Right. So basically the compute on these devices has gotten much more efficient, right? And especially with the introduction of the NPUs, you know, especially when you look at the Qualcomm Snapdragon NPUs, there are 45 tops.
Yep.
It makes a whole lot of difference in terms of your power efficiency.
Okay, and so obviously everyone needs computers, but are there specific employees within an enterprise that would benefit more from having an AI PC? Like, I don't want to focus on, you know, or I don't want to single anybody out,
yeah.
but maybe engineers might, you know, that are designing things might have a better need for it. I'm sure you would love to say just everybody needs one.
That is true,
yeah.
right? that is true. I mean, if you are part of the modern workforce today that is bringing a lot of this multitasking and AI applications into your environment, pretty much each and every person is going to need an AI PC.
All right, so we've got a couple of demos that show the power of what this AI PC can do. So let's jump right into the demo.
Sounds good. So here what I have with me today is the 7455 device.
Okay.
Right? So Dell has partnered with Qualcomm Snapdragon, and we've come up with something great and amazing in terms of AI computing. It is a game changer. Qualcomm Snapdragon processing, right? What that brings is 45 NPU tops. I'm assuming
what's an NPU? That's a neural processing unit, correct?
So that's a neural processing unit. It is an additional processing engine on the silicon.
Mm-hmm.
It is extremely battery efficient, fast. So for all of your AI computing, you basically want to be using the NPU, especially when you're doing all of that local AI compute on your
right.
device.
And TOPS is trillion
TOPS is
operations?
Trillion operations per second.
Yes.
So
that's a number that I can't even comprehend in my brain.
Yeah.
yeah.
And so the more AI tasks you're going to be doing on your local device, the more TOPS that you need.
Okay.
And so that is why, you know, I would say again, each and every person needs at least 40 TOPS or above in their devices.
Okay. So the first demo that we're going to see is called Live Captions, correct?
That's right.
Explain what you're going to be doing here.
Yeah, so Live Captions is part of the Microsoft Copilot Plus load that every person is going to get with their 40 TOPS devices. It really what it does is it makes spoken language so much more understandable
yep.
and permeable, right, in kind of all of our conversations. Now think of an example that you're in a meeting with folks from overseas. They're going to actually suddenly start switching and talking in the foreign language. And
okay.
you're like, wait a minute, what are they saying?
Yeah.
And so if you had this live caption, like I'm going to show you here.
Actually, can we move this way just to, all right, okay.
So that's your live caption up there. It is going to keep translating everything that is going to play on the device, right? So it says, ready to show live captions translated into English.
I'm glad you're translating into
yeah,
English.
Yeah, exactly.
do we know what language we're using here right now?
Oh, we can do anything. So I've got two files for this demo. Let's see. Let's start with the Japanese one.
Okay.
I'm gonna do that. Okay, so I've turned the audio off.
Okay.
And as you can see, it is doing a video playback, but it is translating these messages live. It is doing all of this locally. I'm not connected to the network, by the way.
Wow.
Right? So it's doing this all here. Now, I want to show you one other thing. So while I'm playing this device, oh, let me try to quickly get to it. So task manager, you see what's going on? You see your NPU being processed, whereas your CPU is pretty much sitting idle. Okay. And that's exactly what you want.
Yeah.
You want your CPU to be free, to be able to do the other tasks, to be able to multitask better. Your NPU is way more efficient for all of these AI tasks. So that's basically what's happening. And you have some of the GPU being used because you're doing video playback.
Right, right, okay. And would this be, would live captions be working as well if you had a video conference, if you were?
Yes, absolutely.
If you were live on the other end and they were speaking Japanese to me?
That's exactly right.
And then I could translate from English back to Japanese on their end. I mean, that's like science fiction.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And again, you know, the key to this is that with the IPC, you can do it now, in fact, on the local device itself, right? So you're not having to, again, be connected all the time. You're not having to wait for some of that cloud latency that comes in. Every time you're doing all of this inferencing and AI task computing in the cloud, you have that latency of the cloud. You have, you know, possibly security risks as well. You're constantly sending your data back into the cloud again. And you're racking up costs as well. Every time you hit an inference that hits the cloud, that's a cost. Think of thousands of your end users actually incurring those costs for you in your business.
Yeah, that's amazing. It's just, I could watch this all day. Okay, so we have a second demo, correct?
That's right.
And this one is AI code generation. Yeah. And a lot of our audience are obviously using generative AI to create code. But again, I think that that has latency involved with it if it goes out to the cloud.
That's right.
And cost, like you were saying before.
And that's right. It's some of the common problems that programmers are running into these days, right? So they are doing AI-assisted code generation, but all of this code generation, in most of the cases these days, is happening again in the cloud. So you're going through that same exact thing. I mean, I'm working on super secret projects, and I don't want to be sharing my code into the cloud for obvious reasons. And so I want that device, my data, to stay on the device. I want it to be right here with me.
Right.
I don't want latencies. I don't want to be waiting for that infrastructure in the cloud to be ready, right? You always go through kind of that time allocation of when you can use some of those cloud resources. And then you're racking up costs every time you hit that inference.
Right.
So that's what programmers are running into today. So what I'm going to show you here is we'll, in fact, get into Visual Studio. That's a pretty common code generation tool. Let me start. So here you can see what I've done is we're actually using a Llama chat model. That's a 7 billion parameter model.
Yep.
Pretty decent sized model. Again, running locally on this device. So it's already connected, the model's running already. I'm going to, because I'm not a code developer, I'm going to use one that I've already kind of tried here.
Sure.
So let's see, we're going to put an AI prompt in here. Going to start a new file. Let's keep it a text file. Select the language. I'm going to create an HTML file.
Okay.
Let's create that. Put that in there. Let's put a hash. That's what tells it that it's actually an AI prompt. Okay, so what this one is going to do is really going to generate a simple web page that's going to, every time I refresh it, it's going to show you 8 random numbers, right?
Okay.
So pretty simple code. Let's see how that works.
I like how you say simple code.
So again, I want to point out this, right? Let me start the task manager again. Very similar kind of that performance metrics that you're going to see here, right? Look at that NPU. It's running at full speed.
Yeah.
Your CPU, again, just sitting at 3%. So not much happening there. Again, exactly like you wanted. But it's working it. It's working on the code. Oh, the code's almost already here. So it's actually showing you this code.
And again, you're not connected to the network here.
Not connected to the network.
There's no internet.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So again, the main benefits, saving costs, and not having to connect to the cloud.
That's
and
right.
I like the privacy angle of that as well, where you might be working on something, you don't want any data leakage out there from the cloud.
And when I accept these changes, it's going to, just like, you know, if you've, you know, worked with any programmers, right? You'll see they want it color-coded. They all want all of that code done exactly like that.
Yep.
This took, what does it say? It takes about 12 seconds to do it. This code could have easily taken at least, you know, minutes or not hours, right?
Right.
And imagine you're going to do this for every different type of function that that software programmer is going to want to write.
Yeah.
So you did that in 12 seconds, pretty much. And now I'm going to run that. Let me prove it to you that
okay.
it actually does work.
This is all. This is the code that is going to show the random numbers.
That's
correct?
Right.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to save it. We had something going. There you go, right?
Yep.
I just have to remove that text from there. That's actually comments in the code that it generated telling
yep.
me that, hey, there could be errors. Go verify this is exactly okay. what you need. But every time I refresh, it's throwing out those random numbers, basically.
Okay. That is really cool. All right. So I wanted to ask a question. So because you're not going out on the internet to get all of the AI magic, what
yeah.
I call it, does it put additional software onto the system? Like, is it gonna be bulky software that's sitting on the computer, or is it all built and baked into the AI PC, the little chip and the NPU?
Not really,
yeah.
right? What you do want to make sure is that you have enough memory, right? So based on the size of the model you're using, you're going to need a proportionate size of RAM on your device,
yeah.
for sure. But other than that, it's not putting any other extra software applications. Really what it's doing is it's sending the instructions to the right engine. So you have the CPU, GPU, and now you have the NPU. So as long as the application is going to send those AI instructions to the right engine,
yeah.
it's going to use the NPU, it's going to make it much more efficient.
But even like all of the language translation parts, like all of the language models, that they would sit somewhere in the computer, right?
That's on the computer.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's sitting on the computer.
And that's
anything
not bulky
up to
or anything.
8 billion parameters is great. As long as you have the right RAM ready, you're good to go.
Okay. And there was, I know there was another thing that we didn't want to show, but there was another thing that you had called Studio Effects.
Yeah, Microsoft Studio Effects.
And
yeah.
I thought that was a neat idea too, where if you do a lot of video conferencing,
yeah.
you have meetings, so sometimes they're in Teams, sometimes
right.
they're in Zoom, sometimes
right.
they're in WebEx,
right.
that kind of stuff.
Right.
You have to change your settings every
in
time.
Each of these different applications.
For, yeah, applications for blurring the background.
Right.
Like half the time before I even log into one of these things, I'm like, is my background blurred? Am
right.
I using a virtual one? What do I do?
Right.
This now, this little app will do that for you, right?
Yeah, it makes yeah. it extremely application agnostic,
yeah.
right? So it's like, I want my background blurred all the time. Hey, I want eye correction happening. So even while I'm distracted and multitasking
yeah.
and looking at something else, you know, I can actually be, people can perceive me as actually still looking at the camera.
Yeah. And again, because AI PCs are still relatively new, there will probably be even more and more applications and apps that are coming out that can take advantage of the chip
right.
being on the computer versus, you know, using all of your AI
yeah.
outside on the internet.
I mean, you have things like local semantic search, right? You're basically doing natural language processing on your device today already. You have this, you know, AI-assisted code generation. You have real-time content creation that's happening. All of this is already in your common workforce today.
Yeah.
75% of the users, based on IDC, are actually already bringing AI into their environments.
Yeah.
And 90% of them are actually saying that they're seeing time savings. And this is the steepest kind of adoption and benefit curve I've seen for any technology in a really long time in this
yeah,
industry.
Yeah, and we started the show where we're talking about the battery life. Obviously, we checked before the show.
Yeah.
My computer was already down to 80%.
Right.
And so, you know, how much battery life do you have after we've done all this? You've run through a whole bunch of different things.
Yeah.
What's your battery at right now?
Let's check that.
Let's go check.
That is,
I think you should,
it says 95%.
But
how much time
window.
That is,
yeah.
10 hours and
still
15
still
got
10 hours and 15
mm-hmm.
minutes. I hope you don't have to work, you know, work for the rest of
no,
the day.
No, I hope
for,
not.
Yeah.
I'm going to take the day off.
And there was one more thing you wanted to talk about, the studio
yes,
feature?
Yes, I do want to touch
yeah.
on that, right? So there are things that we want to keep in mind. When we are looking at how AI is becoming pervasive into the workforce, there are going to be two different types of businesses here. Your type one businesses are going to end up using off-the-shelf AI applications. They're not creating stuff themselves, but they're going to take those off-the-shelf applications, deploy it in their environment,
yep.
and their end users are going to reap the benefits of AI. That's all AI inferencing, right? And stop me here when you want more clarification
okay.
on each of these terms.
Oh, I know what AI inferencing
great.
Is. Great. Yep.
And so that's all of AI inferencing. Then there's the type two businesses, which are going to say, hey, no, I'm going to differentiate in the market. I'm actually going to use models, augment data, my own data on these models, create my own applications, train those models, and now go deploy them in my own environment, which is, by the way, what Dell's doing heavily across the organization today. And that is where these businesses are going to see the most competitive benefits for themselves in the market, right? And but there you're seeing there is a piece of AI development as well as AI inferencing. But AI inferencing is everywhere. It is going to be pervasive everywhere.
Yeah.
And to be able to manage all of this AI inferencing in all of these different applications at the same time, you're going to need a device that can handle all of that. So 40 plus TOPS NPU is going to be absolutely necessary for all of that.
Right.
But now again, as all of this is happening, like going back to your question, it is pretty daunting for these businesses to be like, hey, I've got to go generate value really quickly. I want to go differentiate. How do I do it? That's where Dell Pro AI Studio comes in. With our Dell Pro AI Studio, what we will be able to do pretty soon here is businesses can actually use pre-validated models from our Dell Enterprise Hub. They'll take those models, throw their own data on there, tune those models, and now go build applications that are silicon architecture agnostic. So it's going to help you build these silicon agnostic applications. And now you go deploy them via the Dell management portal, the applications, and the models itself, manage them. So, you know, the right versioning system is in there for these models and applications all through your Dell management portal, right? So that end-to-end package, when we have tested it out ourselves internally in our own applications, it's reduced the time end-to-end from 6 months to 6 weeks.
Yes.
That's huge.
Right.
So how fast can you actually reap those AI benefits in your environments? It's that big, that fast.
So companies that invest in these will have a partner moving forward for future AI projects that they want to deploy, correct?
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we've seen statistics that have shown that employees really want to get involved in generative AI and AI
That's
tools.
Right.
So this is another great way to get them involved rather than just having a wall saying, no, we'll we'll decide what AI we want to do at what point.
That's exactly right. I mean, like I said, end users are already bringing those AI tool sets. So if the enterprise isn't going to get ready to handle those workloads, they're either going to see security data issues or they're going to just see productivity tip down for their employees, right? So they absolutely want to be thinking and be more strategic about how they want to bring AI into their environments and help their employees get there versus backdoor AI application entries.
All right, great stuff. Munira, thanks again. Thanks for hosting us here and showing us the AI PCs here.
Awesome. Thank you for the conversation.
That's all the time we have for today's episode. Be sure to like the video, subscribe to the channel, add any thoughts you have below. Join us every week for new episodes of Demo. I'm Keith Shaw. Thanks for watching.